to turn our Bibles to Psalms 107. And then I want to give a good report after what happened last Sunday. I was driving up to Red Lake. Their church starts at 11, so you guys were cranking off prayer here. And just happened to be, as I pull into the parking lot, you're praying for Red Lake. So I got it blaring, and then I just like took the phone and turned it toward the church building. Like, get it, you know, and walked in. I just felt such an anointing. So it was just like, whoa, this is way different than last week. And I really believe it's just because prayers were going up and in a different way. And there were visitors showing up and things like that. And so things weren't going right. You know, whenever God really wants to move, then the sound and everything, you know, they're trying to figure it out. And someone was climbing on the ladder trying to turn on the speakers that were on the ceiling and stuff. So we ended up starting 15 minutes late. And so that can make it feel really nasty, but I could still sense the anointing. I was like, oh, this is strong. So anyways, by the time I got done preaching, the front was full of the majority of the people. And four people got born again. And two were delivered because they were coming out of addiction and, you know, just had some things there. And so, praise God. I mean, I walk out of there higher on Jesus than I had been when I went in. So, but it was pretty cool. And, but I stayed around, I guess, afterwards and chatted because they like to do that. And part of what we were praying for, too, was, I don't know if you got the Amber Alert for a missing child in Red Lake, which I find really odd because there's missing children in Red Lake all the time. The phone would be going off all the time if they really did the deal, right? But this time, most people saw that. And I remember praying and just, you know, saying, God, have mercy and whatever. I know that there's someone in the church there that's related to that incident. So they were there that morning. And it was so great that the one child that had been missing was still alive. But what happened is the person circled back around and burned the other two children to death and was trying to take off with this child, and they caught him. And so it was just like a horrific, you know, so first it's nasty with all, I could feel this presence of God, then it's nasty in the atmosphere just because of all the distractions, and they come forth with this and weeping and things like that. And it's just like, and this is really what Joni said, is just like every other weekend kind of conversation. That's just how intense it is. It's intense here, but it's really intense there. You know, you can be driving to work in the morning if you live on Red Lake and just see someone hanging from a tree that committed suicide. And so the young people there through that shooting that happened years ago already, there's a school teacher now coming to the Red Lake Church, and she said they haven't dealt with it. I mean, these young people are really angry and they haven't dealt with it. And she works in the school system, and she said, you pray before you go into your classroom because they're so full of anger that, you know, they'll attack you just because they can't figure out. You know, there's just so much going on. And, you know, feel anxiety, feel trapped there because they don't know if another shooter is going to come in. And this has been a few years already since this happened. But she said there was no counseling, no nothing. They just moved on. So I believe God's going to give us an opportunity to help in those drastic areas and those things. And I know one of the other pastors that goes up there, and his wife is planning something for children and something for like a women's meeting, and we're going to reach out in the community. I'm planning something outside of the church to go find the one, right? And find that person who is going to spread the news about the church and things like that. So I did get a text from one of the ladies that got saved, and then she showed me what she posted on her Facebook, and she said, you got to come out to my church. She was there one time. She says, it's the best church ever, right? She had not felt the anointing like that, and she said, you got to get here. So that's usually what happens in evangelism. You go find the one, and you meet the need, like God just blows their face off, and then they get so excited, they go out and evangelize. So the picture of like, I got to know the Romance Road and I got to tell everybody this and that's what's going to evangelize. No, it's the people who evangelize. Sheep begat sheep. And it's fast. And so I'm excited about that. We're giving it a few more times to be going up there, and then I'm going to open it up like a mission trip. So we could do a convoy up there or take the bus up there or something like that. Just as a show of love, and then being able to bring the anointing in a different way and get to know the people so that they know that we're connected. Praise God, we were able to, through Ever Blessing, get a bunch of free stuff from Walmart that's left over. They've been giving that to Mission 61, and we funnel it through Ever Blessing. And so, you know, we can only use so much, and then we're going to take the rest of it up to Red Lake. And so that's where the trailer that we bought a couple years ago is going to come in handy, to just fill that, and then I'll pull that up there, and we'll open it up, and people can come and get what they need. So that's the update from prayer. Just one little section of prayer last Sunday morning, and I'm talking cause and effect, right? Pretty exciting. I would be there this morning on the trip up, probably no big deal, but it would be the trip down that I'd be caught and who knows what. And so Vern's like, no. So that's why I'm here this morning. And but I think it's April 14. I'm back up there again. So Psalms 107. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, this is verse 1, for he is good. Could preach on that and do that all morning. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his compassion and loving kindness endures forever. The word endure really gives hang time. You know, if you're enduring something, it isn't like I'm putting up with it. It's more like, no, we're going to do this. We're going to do this, right? And so we can just be, the world is so nasty to God. At the same time, his love endures forever. He just has that hang time with us. Thank God. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from the hand of the adversary and gathered them from the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. They wandered in the wilderness, that was me, in a solitary desert region and did not find a way to inhabit a city or get to the place that they needed to be. Hungry and thirsty, they fainted. They then cried out to the Lord in their trouble and he rescued them from their distresses. He led them by the straight way to inhabit a city where he could establish their homes. I love how the Amplified says that, because literally, as people are getting born again, as we got born again, this fits us. We're wandering around. We don't know where we're going. And we're hungry and thirsty. And then suddenly we cried out to the Lord, and he rescued us from our distresses. He led us by the straight way to an inhabited city where they could establish their homes. You're coming to a place of prosperity, coming to a place where you can start moving about in a way that is free. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his loving kindness and for his wonderful acts to the children of men. For he satisfies the parched throat and fills the hungry appetite with what is good. And it goes on. I won't read all this, but I mean, it's like the whole thing is like, this is what he did. This is what was happening. This is what he did. This is what was happening. This is what he did. But it starts out saying, let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he redeemed from the hand of the adversary. There is power in testimony. There is power in testifying, which is a little bit different kind of prayer, where you testify against something or on behalf of something, right? You're testifying in that. And it's a very joyful, shouting kind of prayer. It's a, you know, it's hard to be like, and then he saved me, and, you know. When you testify, if you're really thankful, it's like, here's how it is. This is what he's done so far. This is what he's capable of doing. And I mean, all things are possible to those. I mean, you testify against the situation. And so that's kind of what happened last Sunday. There was a crying out to God on behalf of Red Lake. But I heard prayers that were assured. Like you can hear different ones on the mic and then pastor praying. It's a sure thing, and faith is operating. And it's like, this is how it's going to be. right? That comes out of our own testimony when we could pray like that. Right? If our last testimony of what God's done from us was in 72, you know, I remember in 72. Remember when that happened? That's a bit ago. That's pretty cool. And you can have the say-so and be redeemed through that. It's great testimony. But what is happening in the now? What's happening in the now? There should be accumulation of, and then he did this for me, and then he did that for me. And it's great to write that in the margins and in the sides of your Bible, because he has done so much for me. It freaks me out how much I've forgotten. I mean, really, you think you remember those big highlighted things. And then all of a sudden, when I watch videos of us in the modular and different things like that, I'm like, oh, yeah, that was the, oh, you know. So it's happening all the time. And it should bring us up into saying so. What are we saying? We're speaking the word. We're coming into a place of agreement. We're announcing some things. We're pronouncing some things. We are declaring. These are types of prayers that many times have volume. Right? And the church overall has toned way down. I'm talking about the body of Christ, or those attempting to be the body of Christ, or those who think they're the body of Christ. You know, but they're in a building that we call church. Just traveling and you know, I've been in different places where you're like, is anyone saved here? It's your church. I mean, that's how intense it is. There's not a movement of the Spirit. There's not a movement there. And so you're sitting in that spot where no one's declaring anything. And it's considered holy the quieter you are. Sometimes it's so holy we have silent prayer. You know, it's like, oh, that was just a holy moment. What'd you say? Nothing. So it is a way that God wants that. That's to change, right? And when we know there's a great awakening, our pie hole starts taking action. The volume does come up. So people who aren't used to that, they'll come to this church, and like last Sunday during that prayer time, it wasn't mouse quiet, right? It was intense. That's why I turned the phone. I'm like, get it, you know, because there was declaration going on. There was a crying out. There was a declaring of the word, and this is how it's going to be, and this is what we're calling for. And so if you're a visitor in that, you're like, because the training is the quieter you are, the more holy it is, you know, right? That's why you get pecked in the knee or you're elbowed from your mom when you were growing up. Shh. You had to sit there like that. Everyone loved going to church like that, didn't you? Just so, you know, sometimes kids just give it up. They're like, I'm just going to go to sleep. And then you got bodies laying. But and even sometimes that, you're not allowed. You just have to sit and stare. So religion will do that. It'll quiet the saints. You can get in the flesh and be loud just because you want to be loud. There is a difference when the redeemed of the Lord say so. It's built out of the testimonies. And this chapter, you know, like verse 12, they stumbled and there was no one to help. Then they cried out to the Lord. Each verse is like, here's how it was going wrong. This is what they did. Here's how it went wrong. Here's how God saved them. Through the whole chapter, it's so powerful. And so when we're in a spot, if we're reciting what's wrong with no second verse, you know, we can say, here's what's happening in America. No second verse, though. We're just, that's what's happening. This whole chapter is like, and then they cried out to the Lord and he saved them. He sent his word and healed them. It's all in that, it's all in that chapter. So they might declare here was the problem, but here came the answer. And I was dealing with someone yesterday that's fighting for their life, fighting for the right to stay here because of a diagnosis. And their faith, though, is just, it's hot. And I just felt so uplifted, because if they stated something's wrong, they had a follow-up of 3-4 verses of how it's going to be right. They had a follow-up, a comeback that's just like, well, that's what they said, but this is how I felt, but, you know, everything. And so I'm like, how can I help you? You got it, girl. You know what I'm saying? It's like, And so we just had a prayer of agreement and things like that. But as we're agreeing, it just dawned on me, like, we are the redeemed saying so. Coming out of testimonies of miracles, this is what happened, but I'm going to say so. God is greater. He is bigger, right? So, and this is where stories or negative things will keep us from taking action. You know, to find out those two little kids were burned to death and everything. Those kinds of things, when they're announced, it's like a shock and awe moment where everyone goes, oh. And if someone doesn't come in faith and say, hey, where do these people live? How can I get to them? What can we do? We need to go in and let the redeemed of the Lord say so. There was a tragedy, but, right? Then we should take some action. It'd be great if it would have been before, but, you know, we should take some action, and there should be that testimony of something great that follows. But if we stop at the problem and we don't declare anything different, it will go the way of the problem, and it just perpetuates. This is why the demonic realm just gets all wiggy when you come into a place and just say so. Just say, yeah, you don't have to be loud or whatever. You can just be talking to somebody like, well, you know, I just believe God is going to. They're like, yeah, God, get out of here. We have this, a condemned area. What are you doing bringing life to it? So you'll find that certain things just get wiggy. I'm fully aware right now that there is someone heavily into witchcraft that is very peeved at us for doing different things. And they've made that announcement, and they're aggravated. And, you know, so I'm just waiting because I got something redeemed to say. That's not a debate. That's not an argument. That's loving the person. Because when you bring God's love to that, doesn't matter how nasty, gnarly it can be, something's going to get redeemed. Because the say-so causes redemption to happen. When you have the say-so, it'll cause it. It'll just ricochet in that atmosphere, and it's like, hello, the feet of them that are bringing good news has showed up, right? Like these feet, you show up, and they're beautiful. Amen? Because you're bringing good news. You're bringing a redemption story. You're bringing something to declare. You're bringing something that will go in the atmosphere. But it doesn't sound like a debate. And it doesn't sound like, I want to correct you. And it doesn't sound crabby. And it's not, it's just there declaring the gospel. Are we able to do that without being crabby? I think we get more people saved when it's not so crabby. And crabbiness comes out of, you know, when we share the gospel, it's not really sharing the good news at that point, but the tone comes out of, I'm actually afraid you're not going to listen to me, so I'm going to get strong out of the gates. And they go, turn their hearing off, and they don't want to hear you anyway, because you're crabby. That's how it comes across, because you want to fight, you want to debate. Just sitting next to somebody and just having a conversation, you can speak the redeemed things into existence in their life. And I have found that just introducing a truth to somebody in casual conversation, I walk away and I already know God's going to take that truth. He's going to do this with it. The kingdom of God is starting to stir. Kingdom of God's right there at hand. I'm right here. I'm at hand. Wherever they go, there they are, and they can't get away from the kingdom of God. Off of one truth that came out of a redemption type statement. Not trying to prove anything, just loving the person, right? Just having conversation. And then we guard our heart with all diligence, because the darkness that might come out of someone's mouth can stir on us too and pull us into the negative. It can have the opposite effect. Am I not right? So conversation, we don't get afraid of that. We're just aware of it, like, oh, wow, my heart's guarded with all diligence, for out of it comes the wellspring of life, which is the redemption story, which has the power to redeem. And the redeemed of the Lord say so. We say so. Amen? And I remember when we first started the church, we were just used to praying, speaking the word. And we were in the house, and it was almost like there were services that we'd go to do that, and the new people would look around like, well, what are we doing? Like, you're going to talk that out loud? You just go randomly say that? Because it was new, right? I'm sure there are places that were doing that, but if you're going to be holy, shh, stand still. We're being holy right now, right? And so it could come across, you could feel just the argument in the atmosphere of like, can we do that? And then people started entering in and calling things that are not as though they were, and everything changed. And then when we were in the revival meetings in the modular, I mean, part of that was people were loosed free to say so. They had something to say. Everybody was praying, and they could say so. And sometimes you fumble around when you're first, you know, trying to take a shot at something, and it might be just a little sentence or a couple words that come out or whatever, but you're saying so. You're loose free to have the say so, because you're the vessel carrying the kingdom. And if all of us are loose free, we're speaking out of the kingdom, what is going to happen to the atmosphere? Amen? What happened up at Red Lake? That's because there was some say-so, even though it's so far away. Well, not far in the spirit. Amen? So we're going to have the say-so on some things here this morning. One of them is I'm asking for prayer for Mission 61. Someone pointed out that, you know, for Mission 61, there's a lot of people going through some things right now. But here's what's true. There's a lot of people going through some things. Every day I get a report of a death or something. And that's outside of Mission 61, right? But they are in our influence, and we have the say-so. So the man that got hit by the car, he is still there. They're not sure about operating on him because his body's so weak, and they're concerned that if they operate, that he'll just pass because of the operation. So they're kind of have him on hold. He's sedated and that type of stuff. He is a believer. He was just starting to come up and to let me have conversations, calling things that are not as though they were. He was a basic believer, we'll call him. You know, he didn't know how to declare things. But he had come to us and had an inability to walk right. He had a walker, the whole thing or whatever. So here he's out riding his bike because God had restored him over a year's period of time. And then somebody missed it and ran into him, right? So there's that. We've had two heart attacks where people were flight for life from our homes, just lower level of the heart kind of stuff. We've had someone who has a vax effect that passed out at work. That's a whole another deal. We had someone who miscarried their baby a little bit back, but, you know, usually they can take care of those things. But, you know, part of the child was not passed. And so then there was infection and there was all this kind of stuff. So there's a lot going on right now everywhere. But I want to specifically speak to Mission 61. We're going to do that here right now. So why don't you stand with me? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. Je crainte ces bras de l'obor de sistea. Zantar le se te te le. Another thing is I've had, I think I'm at 10 people in their 40s approach me for prayer for getting rid of cancer. That's in the last 2 weeks. So we're throwing that in the mix too. How about that? Si se le brete se crete di alla hardalasa singrete di assumbrete di astea. So the Lord gave us a rhema, and it's Isaiah 61. You can pray in the spirit while I speak Isaiah 61 over Mission 61, because that's the mission. So we're reminding the atmosphere what the mission is. This is what the Lord has said about our housing for people in crisis. The Spirit of the Lord God is up on me, because the Lord has anointed and commissioned me to bring good news to the humble and the afflicted. That is our purpose. Hallelujah. We're going to continue to do so. He has sent me to bind up the wounds of the brokenhearted, to proclaim release from the confinement and condemnation to the physically and spiritual captives. So they are being loosed from their physical and spiritual captivity in the mighty name of Jesus. When they signed that contract to move into the home, they came under this chapter. They came under the vision of this chapter. They came under it. And we are the redeemed of the Lord that say so. To proclaim release. They're released in the name of Jesus. And freedom to prisoners. Yes, hallelujah. We have four people that just came out of jail. Oh, hallelujah. To proclaim the favorable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance and the retribution of our God. He is moving on every situation in every home, bringing us up, 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 up into holy faith, into a place of redemption, into a place where we declare, Lord God, prosperity in all things, in all ways, at all times, to comfort all who mourn. So many, Lord God, are there to mourn, they're mourning, and you are comforting them. To grant to those who mourn in Zion the following, to give them a turban instead of dust on their heads, a sign of mourning. The oil of joy instead of mourning comes upon them. The garment expressive of praise instead of the disheartened spirit. So they will be called the trees of righteousness, strong and magnificent. Distinguished for integrity, justice, and right standing with God. Fall upon each and every one of them, whether they're in the hospital or in the homes, Lord God, their workplace today. Fall upon their situations and bring about righteousness and justice. Bring it about, Lord God. So many are orphans. And we are acting on their behalf as of standing in the spot like a foster parent. Foster means to stand in the spot of. And we're speaking to each situation. Come up into the holiness of God. Come up into the blessing. The planting of the Lord that he might be glorified. Then they will rebuild the ancient ruins. That's the verse that we stand on. We are rebuilding the ancient ruins, and they will raise up and restore the former desolations, and they will renew the ruined cities, the desolations, deserted settlements of many generations. So this is generational, Lord God, and we address those things that are generational. We thank you that you are moving, you're breaking every curse, you're breaking every part of bondage, you're breaking off addiction, you're breaking it. Break, 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 break now in the name of Jesus. Freedom, freedom. Strangers will stand and feed your flocks, and foreigners will be your farmers and your vine dressers. But you shall be called the priests of the Lord. People will speak of you as ministers of our God. That's who we are. That's who we are, and that's what they will become. You will eat the wealth of nations. We call the houses paid for. We call the houses so we can reach out to more people, Lord God. We want more people. We want to take care of the ones we have and more people. And so we thank you that we will eat the wealth of nations and we will boast of their riches. Instead of your former shame, you will have a double portion. We are in, see, ooh, this is a good verse for all of you. Double portion, kind of anointing. And instead of humiliation, your people will shout for joy over their portion. Woo! Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Therefore, in the land, they will possess double what they had forfeited. They're in this land. They're under this mission. We're in this land. We're under this mission. And so we have that ability to possess the double what they had forfeited. Everlasting joy will be theirs, for I, the Lord, love justice. I love justice. I love justice. I hate robbery with a burnt offering, and I will faithfully reward them and make an everlasting covenant with them. Then their offspring will be known among the nations. Our offspring also will be known among the nations, and their descendants among the people. All who see them in their prosperity, that's the word the atmosphere doesn't like, in their prosperity will recognize and acknowledge them, that they are the people who the Lord has blessed. Woo! I will rejoice greatly in the Lord. My soul will exalt in my God, for he hath clothed me with garments of salvation. Salvation means to take the limits off through by the finger of God. That's one of the meanings. And a great release. Whew, a great sending away of sin. And I'm dressed in that. You're dressed in that. They're dressed in it. As a bridegroom puts on a turban, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth the sprouts, and as a garden causes what is sown into spring up, so the Lord God will most certainly cause righteousness and justice and praise. It'll spring up before all the nations through the power of his word. How is this all going to happen? Through the power of his word. We yield to that same anointing, Lord God, that same anointing that causes a double portion. It causes it as we yield to you, as we repent, as we come before you, you bring about justice and righteousness, and the vision of each and every one of our hearts that you put in there will come to pass, and it will be that blessing of double portion that will fuel it. We receive that for our building situation. We receive the double portion right now. He's the God of more than enough. He's the God of more than enough. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Shaddai, you are the God of more than enough. Hallelujah. Our cup runneth over. He anoints our head with oil, and our cup runneth over. We are not afraid of the word prosperity. We're people that are afraid don't know how to steward. So we ask for the stewardship anointing. That anointing that comes on so that we think heavenly thoughts about finances. We think heavenly thoughts about operation. We think big picture thoughts like God does of cause and effect on the nations. Woo! Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Sarah, you're about to go to Israel, right? And the date is April 7th. Can you come up here and we'll pray for you? Now, you can pray the country. It's just what I read, how powerful it is, right? We could go back to religion and pray the prayer like, Lord, help Sarah. Protect her. You know, do that whole thing. Or speak the word of faith over her and let the redeemed of the Lord say what's going to happen. We could actually do that, right? So just stretch your hand toward her and let God allow you a word inside to just speak that toward her in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We don't plead with him for protection. We call protection. Hallelujah. You protected her before, and you'll do it again, Lord God. And even according to Isaiah 61, Lord, she falls into that category. You brought her up out. You brought her up out. Her background, Lord, she's been letting that go and taking you on. And so you're the one going on the mission trip. You're the one that's using her body to go on this mission trip. And the kingdom of God inside of her is going to operate. And the Holy Spirit up on her is going to operate. And the angels that are assigned to her get to operate in anything that is needed in the moment. We call the blessing a double portion. We are in the last days, even double portion of anointing blessing. So the cause and effect is greater, 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 greater in the name of Jesus. Evangelistically, healing, healing, deliverance. Thank you, Lord. Thank go rebuild the ancient ruins. The place is long devastated. And the place is presently being devastated. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Praise you. Praise you, Lord God. Let's have the band just come up and be in position. When we recognize the power that's in the word, we're actually recognizing the power of Jesus. Right? So if we separate those two and we're like, well, I don't know, I spoke some Bible verses over it. No, you spoke Jesus over it because Jesus is the word. Jesus is Yeshua. Yeshua means salvation. You took some limits off a situation by speaking the word. Because this word is not limiting you, it's freeing you. So when you bring the word, the redeemed of the Lord say so and free up the atmosphere, free up the situation. That's what happened. I know I was walking into something that was just horrible testimony, horrible things. Things weren't going right last weekend, right? But you were here speaking the redeemed of the Lord kind of statements and saying, actually, this is how it's going to go. So then, you know, we don't have to succumb to what was going on in the atmosphere. You just override that. Just override that. So if you ever are in a spot where you're ministering or there's something going on where all of a sudden it just feels funky, you don't get louder to override it. You just come up in your most holy faith and be like, Lord, what is the word for this situation? And you let everybody do their little freak out thing or whatever it is that's going on, and you begin to speak the word. The whole atmosphere changes. Even if you're speaking it under your breath because you're in a spot where you can't say it louder, the whole atmosphere will change. To spring up before all the nations, and how is this going to happen? Through the power of his word. It's his word. And that's where, you know, anything just starts happening. I pull out Isaiah 61 and announce that when it comes to like Mission 61. Coming under the mission. Submission means that I'm here coming under the mission, right? Of what God has ordained. It isn't, I just listen because I have to submit. It's no, here's a mission. Yes, I feel good about that. I'll come under that mission and support it. But how do you do that? With the power of his word. Hallelujah. Safety is on this congregation because of the anointing. So as we leave here today, we're going to drive in it and we're going to be all right. Right? So we don't go doing something stupid, but we're just going to drive in it and be all right because we're protected. Amen? Amen. I thought I'd throw that into the atmosphere. So right now, we turn our thoughts toward worship, Lord God. And we're pressing into you because you said those who worship will worship in spirit and truth. And where the presence of the Lord is, there is liberty. Once again, liberty means emancipation from bondage. So as we're in the presence of the Lord, if there's something going on in our physical body, something going on in our household, something going on with our finance, it doesn't matter what it is, we take it, we roll the care over it onto him. Our thoughts line up with his will, which is his precepts, his commands, his ways of doing things. And when we worship you, you emancipate us right out of that bondage. Woo! And then we just say so. We're being redeemed. We're being redeemed. We're being redeemed. There's somebody here or watching online, and maybe there's more than one, I'm sure, that you've been crying out to God because there's financial issues. Some of it is your stewardship issues, and you need to get some education on how to steward. Just saying. You know, steward is how you handle the money, because you might think you're doing the right thing, but it might be backwards, right? You might have the cart in front of the horse and just need somebody to speak into that. And that'll change some things up. But other things are attached to the finances. It's fear. And fear does not speak the word. Fear will not give you permission to declare prosperity. That's why the spirit of poverty messes with your pie hole. Faith is nigh thee even in thy mouth. It won't come out your mouth. You'll say nothing at all, or you will say the wrong thing. It's always been this way for me, right? And you can't have what you speak against. That's a rule in the kingdom. You can't have what you speak against. So we thank you, Lord God, financially. We lay that before you. You're a double portion God. You're a God that's 30, 60, 100-fold kind of God. You're the God of multiplication. You're the God who wants us to know how to steward so that the blessing doesn't take us out. So that we're not standing in a spot where the blessing itself eats us because we don't know how to operate in it. Grow us, Lord God, this year. Grow us like cray cray. Get us in a spot where we're able to receive the blessing and steward it properly. Right information, right timing. And we take those finances and honor you. That's what drives the spirit-led steward's heart. Here's my paycheck. I want to honor you. Show me. Show me, Lord, what to do. And so a big part of stewardship is humbleness in your kingdom. But the other part that's sitting on these situations is, you can talk spooky and be a curse, right? Like there's some kind of voodoo witchcraft. But a curse means to be subtracted from, and it can come out of your way of thinking. Right? So let's come against that right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Take your finances, bring them before the throne of God in your hour of need, Lord God. I mean, you might not even have a big need, but you're believing God for something else to come in so you can be a giver to something else, and there's something blocking it. And so we come against that in the mighty name of Jesus, and we align with how you set up seed time and harvest. We align through the tithe. We align through seed time and harvest, the right attitude right now in the name of Jesus. We are loosed free to prosper in all things, in all ways, at all times. Amen? Someone say something a little. If you had a hard time saying that, poverty is at your door in your soul. If you had a hard time declaring that, there needs to be some redemption. You don't have a hard time declaring your salvation. Well, prosperity is part of your salvation. Amen? Yeah, we went up, we went down, we went up. Woo, but now we're going to worship. Praise you, Lord Jesus.